evening and welcome to this 10 past 9 session. I have a quick show of hands before we start. All of us came to this hacker event. Whom of you decided to install some software updates before you decide to come here? So I see quite some event. So now keep your hand raised if you could do this for all the stuff you brought here. Still some hands. Same thing at home? No. So do any of you own devices which are not able, you are not able to update? I have some in my pocket even. So we have a bit of a problem, which really fits the next speaker well. Let me update you on Rejo, who's our next speaker. Rejo is a privacy advocate. He works as a policy analyst. He works for Bits of Freedom, the leading Dutch digital civil rights society, as a policy advisor. He's also the co-founder of Freedom Inc., where he fights for your fundamental rights. But tonight, he will talk to you about patching our approach to software updates. So please give a warm hand to Rejo Zenger.
Well, thanks for having me. I'm Rejo Zenger, and I work for Bits of Freedom, a digital civil rights organization in the Netherlands, as you've just been told. It feels special to be here, as Bits of Freedom has been resurrected from a winter sleep 8 years ago at an earlier incarnation of this event. 8 busy years, by the way. You may have heard from us in our fights against the introduction of a power to hack for the Dutch police, a NSA-styled dragnet surveillance provision for the intelligence services, and making sure that our government opposes the weakening of encryption, none of which I will be discussing during this talk, by the way. And if you've been following Bits of Freedom for some time, you have noticed that we have a brand new website and a new logo. And of course, that comes with the obligatory new t-shirts. That's a hint. Anyways, in this talk, I will list a number of updates we need to apply to our updates, or more accurately, update the process of deploying security updates. Traditionally, we are focused primarily at delivering a product and not the aftercare. If we think about updates, we think about rolling out new features and not about fixing the vulnerabilities in existing features. And that usually comes as an afterthought. And whenever we look at the process of deploying security updates, we mostly do that rather narrow-minded. We have a look at the part of the process where we can directly influence rather than looking at the total, at the entirety of the process. And we tend to fix the issues for ourselves, but forget to look at the other stakeholders relevant to the process. But works for me is, I think, just not good enough. It's not good enough if we want to have a reliable process where we can deploy security updates. If you have fixed your part in the process, but further down the chain there are still some issues, the process of updating is far from optimized. You may provide security updates quickly, but if the user doesn't trust those updates, your updates will not be installed and your product remains vulnerable. So here we have 12 updates fixing some of the common issues surrounding the process of deploying security updates. But first, I'll start with a few words on the need of a reliable process where security updates are made available and deployed swiftly upon becoming aware of some vulnerability. I'll keep that brief, as all of you in this room are fully aware of all the risks that come with vulnerabilities. In fact, much of what is happening right now has been foretold by many of you. After the short introduction, I'll discuss the 12 top most important updates to the process of patching vulnerabilities. Of course, it's easy to describe the vulnerabilities, but it's much harder to actually fix them. So in the last part of this talk, I will highlight the roles and responsibilities we all have in this process. And to be honest, I would be surprised, or maybe even disappointed, if I would tell you something completely new. But only rarely I hear someone piecing all of this together. And as already mentioned, that is urgently needed because the process of deploying security updates is as strong as its weakest link. Many of today's technologies are said to be disruptive, and in most cases, what is meant is that these new technologies can turn a market quickly and completely upside down. But digital attacks of this year have shown that technology can easily disrupt our entire society. For example, the WannaCry malware forced hospitals to close down, even though the malware was aimed at holding data ransom for money. Anyone who has doubts about the potential impact of such disruption only has to look at the NotPetya attack. When the disruption had been only a little bit longer, then our supermarkets would have been unable to stock at least for some of the products. And such disruption doesn't have to be directly aimed at society. It can be a political weapon as well. Or a weapon of, let's say, a drugs cartel abusing the chaos at the container terminals in the port of Rotterdam. We have become utterly dependent on our digital infrastructure. Oddly enough, we behave differently. While swiftly resolving vulnerabilities in this digital infrastructure, it is tremendously resolving vulnerabilities in this digital infrastructure is tremendously important, the deployment of security updates seems to be something of the lowest priority. As an example, one of the vulnerabilities that was abused by both WannaCry and NotPetya was a vulnerability that was kept secret by the NSA, apparently for years. But even when the patch was available, many sites wouldn't or couldn't install that update right away. We should do better, and here are some ideas. In the Netherlands, the government has a long history of failed IT projects, and the legislation that is passed often doesn't meet the needs for a secure digital infrastructure. However, there are exceptions, and the National Cybersecurity Center is one of them. They are acting like a computer emergency response team to governmental institutions on a national level. They do really good work. Anyway, the NCSC organizes a yearly conference. It's named the One Conference. This year, they had 11-year-old Ruben Paul on stage. And the boy was playing around with his teddy bear and hacked the poor thing via its Bluetooth connection. Of course, this talk has seen a lot of headlines in all the large media because everyone admires an 11-year-old hacking his teddy bear. But there was much less attention for the fact that a random toy can be hacked without years of training, and this tells this is telling for the way we deal with security of the things connected to the internet. All it takes is an inquisitive mind. Another thing that seems to have been missed by all of the media: the fact that someone has found a vulnerability doesn't suddenly and by magic make it secure. The manufacturer still needs to be able to push an update to the teddy bear. That is possible, but only if the manufacturer visits all of the homes of the kids with this plush toy. There's no way of installing a patched version of the software running inside the bear using some other means than physical interaction. And that obviously is not realistic. The device may be smart, but the manufacturer is definitely not. So there should be a process in the first place to update. The only solution that remains is to throw out and replace the device when a vulnerability is discovered. And that's not a very sustainable solution. A more sustainable solution would be that it becomes not done to sell products that are connected but cannot properly update it. As a consumer, you should expect nothing less. And of course, it may be cheaper for a manufacturer to not to provide updates and not to provide a mechanism for updating, but that should become a liability. Of course, it's easy to blame companies running older and sometimes even end-of-life versions of Windows for not having upgraded to a more recent version of the operating system. The same holds true for my friend's dad, who still is using a computer with Windows XP. And despite all the warnings and interrupting his workflow many times, he still hasn't upgraded. He rejected the idea even when there was a new version of Windows made available for free. Nor could today's user-friendliness of Ubuntu change his mind. For my friend's dad, an upgrade is much more than just upgrade to a newer version of the software. It's also adapting to a new look, new icons, new functionality, and getting rid of old habits. So how do you encourage someone like my friend's dad to take such a big step? How many warnings is he allowed to just ignore? And what about industrial environments? For a large factory with many dependencies, things may not be that simple. Upgrading the operating system on one component of the robot may entail a costly replacement of all the robots. Maybe there should be something as a rule that a computer running an outdated operating system may no longer be connected to a network, let alone the internet. Or maybe the computer should no longer be able to boot after its operating system has expired. I don't know how we should solve it, but this needs to be different, of course. It's I think also a difficult dilemma for the software manufacturer. At a certain point, software should be allowed to become end of life, and you really cannot expect the manufacturer to provide software updates for eternity. So no security updates without considering the upgrades as well. Just looking at the process of updating does not resolve all the issues surrounding security vulnerabilities. If we truly want to make a difference there, we also need to look at the process of upgrading. How to make sure that a company's robots or the computer of my friend's dad is running a recent version of some operating system. If the barrier for upgrading is too high, making a point about a lacking deployment of security updates, I think, is futile. And here's another obvious point. One of the reasons the hospitals in the United Kingdom were affected by the WannaCry ransomware was that people are exceedingly cautious about making changes to a software of systems where we have a high level of dependency. And that's, of course, understandable. If the software isn't thought out well enough, such an update could make the system crash. And you don't want to have that happen in a hospital, a police station, or at the air traffic control. Therefore, such institutions test updates thoroughly before installing them. And that requires a thorough investment in capacity and time. Probably, it's much more efficient to collect a number of updates and do the testing in a single run. But it also adds to the time it takes before a security update is actually deployed. So, security updates shouldn't break a thing. That has to change. Security updates should be installable quickly, especially if the potential consequences of a vulnerability are large. That means that manufacturers should minimize the risk that the patch breaks something, for example, by making the patch as small as possible, and a patch should therefore only do that, patch the vulnerability. It also means that manufacturers should inform users well about the nature of an update, the potential consequences of applying the patch, and possibly even assist where the software is used in devices upon which lives depend. In a professional environment, that means a manufacturer may need to take a more active role than he is used to up until today. It also means that the users should be explained in a meaningful way that what a particular update actually contains. This one from Spotify is an example of how it should not be done. Basically, it repeats, "We are always making changes and improvements to Spotify," and repeats it as a mantra. Every change is just that. Meaningless change logs should be something of the past. One of the more prominent victims of the NotPetya attack has been the logistics giant Maersk. You know them, of the containers in the port of Rotterdam. At least two of its container terminals in Rotterdam were seriously hit. The cargo could not be unloaded, ships had to be diverted, and trucks could not pick up or deliver containers. The damage is estimated to be in the hundreds of millions of euros, and nearly a month later, Maersk was still struggling with the fallout. Internal documents of the company reveal that the company has been warned many times about its lacking security over the course of several years. Apparently, there was no network segmentation, no firewalls, no monitoring, and no virus scanners in place. The response of the management in 2016, "We will not fix these vulnerabilities as updating and reorganizing means downtime." Lazy and stupid, of course. I'd say it's better to have a short and scheduled interruption than an unexpected and longer disruption. And Maersk, of course, is not an isolated example. So sometimes process-related problems are the cause of a slow installation of updates. Some companies are required to have the entire infrastructure to be recertified before they may take it into production again. If such organization has to go through the entire certification process every time they install a new update, it is no surprise that a company chooses to collect all those updates in a single run. The result, longer periods of vulnerabilities. What also happens, an organization depends on an external company for administration of their computer systems, and if they don't have time right away, the organization has to wait for them as well. So an update of this process should not be just talking about the updates, but also about the process around it. It should update all of the related procedures. So it means that the process of applying those patches should also be structured differently. Something else. How much did your mobile phone cost? The answer that most of us will give probably is a few hundred euros, sometimes even up to 1,000. For most of us, the data on a mobile phone is a fairly complete reflection of one's lives. It includes your holiday pictures, your most intimate chats, your internet banking, and a continuous record of your whereabouts. Therefore, I'd say, it's not unreasonable to expect that the manufacturer of your phone to support it for at least a couple of years, maybe 4, maybe 6, especially if you include secondhand use. And if a vulnerability with impact on security of your data comes to light during the time, it's reasonable to expect to receive an update to resolve that vulnerability. The reality is different. Some mobile phones were already unsupported on the day the phone was sold as new. And it's not just me who is worried about this. The Dutch consumer organization Consumentenbond has started a court case against Samsung. It has asked the court to order Samsung to provide all of its smartphones in the Netherlands for a period of 4 years after their placement on the market, or 2 years after the time of the sale by Samsung or through a retail channel, with updates that repair these vulnerabilities in the software. In my opinion, those 2 years are still very short, but it's definitely better than the current situation. So security is something that is an ongoing concern, or there should be an ongoing concern. I strongly believe that the manufacturers should provide security updates for as long as the reasonable lifetime of a product. That can't be too much to ask, right? And this is the easy part, the support for just a couple of years. But once we have connected everything to the internet, we are talking about a lifespan of a decade for some of the devices. Older cars and fridges should also receive those updates. It would be fairly dumb if a car could no longer be driven safely just because the manufacturer does not want to provide the necessary support. In a case of a mechanical malfunction, your local garage may be able to help out, or you can hack your car yourself. But because the source code of the software the car is running on is a company secret, that is becoming increasingly difficult. And from the viewpoint of environmental sustainability, it is also a complete disaster to have to replace a car after 10 years just because security updates will no longer be provided. And here's another complication that remains unanswered for now. What to do if the manufacturer has meanwhile gone bankrupt? I don't know, actually. I know one thing for sure. If I myself need to check regularly for security updates, I'm vulnerable most of the time. This becomes less of an issue if my connected devices look for a new update on their own and then notify me if there's a new update available. However, of course, often this notification is shown at moments I don't have the time to deal with it. So the apps on my phone, however, they are almost always up to date. It happens automatically and I hardly notice it. Once every few days I check what has changed, and I'm convinced that for the vast majority of users and devices, this works perfectly. Especially if the security updates are just that, security updates. So I think that normally automatic installation of security updates, that should be the default. And of course, when someone suggests to introduce or to enable automatic updates, there's always someone saying that you don't want automated changes to a running system. And indeed, there is of course a risk of a crash when a running system is updated behind the scenes. My response is twofold. Firstly, the solution should then not be to disable those updates, but to improve those updates. The manufacturer should be able to say, We have so much confidence that our product still works after an update that we do not even have to ask you. If it gives you any shit, then they will come to resolve it. Secondly, there may be exceptions in specific cases. Some people in this room may have to deal with a threat model that requires you to take a different approach. Therefore, automatic updates should be the default, but at the same time, the user should be able to opt out. And yes, there are still some unresolved issues. What if the security updates requires a reboot or interrupts the user's process? We need to find some clever solutions around that. But as a general rule, automatic installation of security updates are good, I think. So what is it what most users will do if their browser interrupts their workflow with a pop-up window that urges the user to install an update to prevent losing files? And would that decision be any different if the user sees the message right after hearing about a worldwide attack with ransomware? There's a good chance that the user will click the install button. But there's an equally good chance that the user is not installing a security update, but malware the user just wanted to prevent from being installed. The point is, in many cases, the checks on the authenticity of an update are not done well enough. And then you get the question, is the offered update actually coming from the manufacturer or is it from someone else? So we need to ensure that the deployment of security that the security update is installed and not just the malware. Systems should be designed in such a way that the user only installs those security updates from a trusted source. And I think that for a large part, this can be done. This can be enforced technically by signing and verifying the update, encrypting the payload, and the use of certificate pinning and other means like that. Of course, this means that the manufacturer needs to make an even bigger effort in protecting its own infrastructure. This has been perfectly illustrated by the NotPetya attack. Both the initial attack pushing the backdoor as well as the push of the malware were done by using the host's regular update check. And obviously, there shall be no exceptions for our governments. To abuse the security update process seems quite trivial if you want to place a backdoor in, say, WhatsApp. Suppose law enforcement wants to read the WhatsApp messages of a specific user. They are unable to read the chats in transit due to the end-to-end encryption. So suppose law enforcement doesn't have access to that device. Then law enforcement might force WhatsApp to push an update to a specific user that disables the encryption of all messages to and from that one user. Or they can covertly add an additional key to encrypt all the messages to. That will make the chat comprehensible even when intercepted in transit. And of course, the first time that will be very, very effective, and maybe the police can use this to prevent a couple of murders. But what this also prevents is that internet users installing security updates. Users will no longer automatically install security updates if they can't trust those updates. They need to be sure that governments are not abusing the security update process for their own gain. So we need to make sure that the trust of users in security updates is maximized. Our governments must make courageous statements speaking against abusing the process of security updates for offensive measures. That will be hard, but not impossible, I think. Take, for example, the Dutch government that last year published a statement in which it said that it finds the weakening of encryption undesirable. That should be the same for using security updates for offensive attacks. And while talking about governments, here's another one. Security updates and 0 days, that doesn't work together. Manufacturers must be made aware of every vulnerability found, especially if such a vulnerability potentially has an impact on the digital security of the general public. And with this audience, this doesn't need any more explanation. But governments should not keep vulnerabilities as a secret. Governments should not participate in the market for unknown vulnerabilities. And they should renounce the purchase of devices that exploit those 0 days. Here's something else. Apple's announcement of the new version of their mobile operating system garnered quite some attention because of its facelift of the so-called lock screen and notification center. A new design, new settings, That's nice for those who want to have these new things. But anyone who is happy with the current functionality may decide not to install the update. Although the choice is understandable, it is not without undesirable consequences. Because if you do not install this update, you are sooner or later also deprived of any security update that builds upon this unwanted update. So I think security updates, they should be separated from the feature updates. So manufacturers should distinguish between security updates and other updates. The user should be able to install security updates that resolve vulnerabilities without being forced to accept changes in functionality. That's something that is done by Ubuntu quite well. There you can choose to have your computer only install security updates while ignoring all non-essentials. Or to put it more strongly, every hurdle that hinders the installation of a security update should be removed where possible. That means that the availability of a security update should not depend on the contractual agreements between the manufacturer and the user, or that the user may be forced to pay for an update that resolves a vulnerability. And the same holds true for other changes in, for example, a smartphone. An update that comes with changes in a setting or permissions or change in permissions that an app requires will also prevent the quick adaption of that security update. So these are 12 changes, I think, 12 fixes for issues with the current process of deploying security updates. And it's, of course, very easy to identify them, but deploying that is a lot more difficult. So how to deploy these updates? A good thing is, none of these changes require a complete overhaul of the architecture or the principles on which we work. It does, however, require a change of attitude and habit. And because the interests of the stakeholders aren't aligned, this will be a big challenge nevertheless. It seems obvious to look at the manufacturers of hardware and software for help. After all, they are the ones that develop and maintain most of these systems that we want to update when necessary. However, investing in the update process is not something their shareholders will cheer on. It costs money and yields very little, especially in the short term. So I'm afraid that manufacturers are not going to deliver the solution. Of course, companies benefit from users that have a great trust in digital infrastructure they use, but the benefits of increased trust are not directly visible or easy to monetize. It has to come from the entire industry. So you can be, of course, the only company that produces a secure, connected teddy bear, which then comes with a higher retail price and which will make it more difficult to sell. But if the rest of the industry is not following you, trust will not grow. And as we all know, it is not realistic to think that an entire industry will suddenly start to show corporate social responsibility. No, we shouldn't expect much from manufacturers, and that means that the government has a role to play here. The common interests are simply too large to just let the bad outcome happen. We should force manufacturers with laws and regulations, unfortunately. And even though I have a preference for small-scale rules, this is something that needs to be done on a transnational level. The Netherlands, for example, depends far too much on foreign manufacturers for our systems. Moreover, even if we would have a very secure product in the Netherlands, if the rest of the world attacks us, we're still doomed. So ideally, we therefore regulate this at a global level, and that may be a little bit too far-fetched and taking too long. So this has to be put on the Brussels agenda soon. Compare it to safety belts and cars, mandatory because of the societal damage and deaths that we would suffer otherwise. And the good thing is, the safety belts also allowed us to drive even faster without great risk. Such rules should enforce a few things. Manufacturers should be forced to use secure protocols, standards, and default settings. Security researchers who discover a vulnerability in a responsible manner should be able to report it without fear of repercussions. And companies should be forced to provide security updates quickly and adequately. The new rules should also ensure that companies are liable for the societal damage they cause if they are sloppy about the security of their products. And of course, not only rules, but also strict enforcement. if the rules are violated. But the government should also consider its own policies. It cannot be the case that the government participates in the market for 0 days or that it hijacks the process for installing security updates to create a backdoor. And last but not least, we need to convince the internet user to ask hard questions. It helps if the users are aware of the risks. If they are aware of the risks, they need to think about the risks of what happens to their most intimate photos created on a device that has many vulnerabilities and no security updates available. And I'm afraid that we will need to have some more of these disruptions before users truly understand the potential risks. But even then, awareness amongst users will not solve all of these issues. You cannot expect the average Joe to correctly consider all security aspects of a device, which is not a reason why it's time for the government to step in. So the takeaway, we need users of any kind to trust security updates. To get there, we need to look at the entire process, not just at some isolated components. In this talk, I've mentioned quite a few of those components. I'm very happy to hear if I missed one or two. But I'm convinced we need to update the process, so the entire process of deploying security updates. It will be a challenge that we cannot do without. And that's where I want to leave it. Question everything, please. Thank you.
So please, if you have a question, line up on the front or the back.
You suggest that the government should regulate this behavior that you are in favor of. But let's say that in Europe this would happen. We all know how many devices come from China, and they will not be subjected to anything because people buy them and get them delivered without any interference of any government, I think.
Yes.
So how do you look on that?
So I'm not sure whether regulation will solve all of the issues. I guess there still will always be insecure devices, of course. But I do think that that we can regulate for the more important devices, we can regulate this. You can have, we also have for other systems, you also have some regulation that requires to have devices meet some standards. If the device, even if it's made in China, doesn't meet those standards, it is not allowed on the European or the Dutch market. And I think we can do something similar with this as well. It will not solve every issue because, of course, you still can buy and connect insecure devices from abroad. But I do think that especially for the more important devices, we can regulate this.
Please go ahead.
Hi, Rejo. First of all, thanks so much for the work Bits of Freedom has been doing in the Netherlands and for proposing digital rights in the Netherlands. That's awesome.
Thank you.
I'm a bit surprised that you're proposing regulation here so much because regulation is slow. And if we look at the practices of regulation recently by the Dutch government and European government, I cannot say I'm a big fan.
No.
Then next to that, a regulation is always a little bit too late. So aren't we going to regulate and say that what are the best practices today? They might end up in regulation in 5 years, at which time those regulations are going to be outdated. So we're going to say that you're going to use old standards that are then already practically insecure. So shouldn't we actually be using standards bodies for that? Or how would you approach that problem? Yep.
So that's a good question, and I'm not in favor of even more rules, just like you, so I do understand the question. I think that the regulation is some kind of a last straw we are holding on to, because I don't believe that this will be fixed by those companies producing those devices themselves. And the reason for that is something which I already mentioned, is that I think that the it costs them too much to make it really secure. So they don't have an incentive to make it secure, and that will not change unless there's some external force forcing them to do that. And of course, there are many ways. So regulation would be one. Standard bodies would be another one. I'm not sure whether if there would be standards, then companies will still oblige those standards. So I think that there needs to be some external force in order to have those companies make secure products. It's not something which I like, but I don't see this happen otherwise, because companies will not do that themselves, I'm afraid.
I fully agree. Can I ask a follow-up question, or am I then?
First.
Sorry, just interrupt you again. And there's one more thing. You also mentioned the role of our governments in the Netherlands and in Europe. I also think it's very, very important to look at their role themselves, because they also play an important role in how we secure our digital infrastructure. So, for example, the Dutch government recently, the Dutch government wants to have the Dutch police to be able to hack into a computer via the internet. Of course, thank you. Of course, they need to have a vulnerability for that. So you could say the Dutch government has an incentive to keep those vulnerabilities secret. My plea would be for additional regulation, but my plea would be also to have governments doing the good things and not introducing legislation that is an incentive to keep those vulnerabilities secret.
To have him ask another question.
Sure. So, in the back. You had a follow-up question, right?
Yeah. So, the question is, if we start regulating this, for instance, in the Netherlands, we've seen proposal regulation on security of IoT coming out last week in the US. Ron Wyden came up with this idea that IoT devices should be updatable, should not have hard-coded passwords in the firmware, which all sounded very reasonable. So if we have different regulations in different countries, then we end up with a regulatory complete mess in which we end up in further breaking up, fragmenting the internet. That's a serious problem. So if you would like to think about regulating, at what level would you propose on doing that? And would you say that the UN has a role in that? Or would you then rather put it to the standards bodies? Because we've seen that in the General Assembly, Security Council, or even worse, in the ITU, the favor is more towards the China-Russia bloc than towards people more in favor of security.
So I think it would be, for companies, it would be very convenient if there were the same rules just about everywhere. But unfortunately, I'm afraid that if we want to do this globally, it will take too long to build those rules. There's a process that will take tens of years, that's way too long. So that's why I was saying that I believe that this should be done on a lower level, so probably on a European level for a starter, and maybe the Europeans can have a conversation with the US and we can seem to align those regulations. But I think it's way too important to have those companies produce secure devices than to make sure that everywhere in the world we have the same rules, because that would take too long. So that's my preference, would be as on a higher level, but not too high that it takes too long. Yeah?
The gentleman in front.
Hi, Rejo. you talked about liability of the people who create the software. What are your thoughts on the liability of the people who write open source, or my preferred term, free software, which often comes with the text that you can't assume that it does anything, basically. Use it at your own peril. Would that be okay? Is there an exemption? What are your thoughts?
Well, at least there's one very huge difference between the closed and the open source software. So with the open source software, of course, I don't have to explain it, I think. Someone is able to look at the code, someone is able to hack the code, to change it, and to make its own adjustments. So I would say that the liability obligations would be should be higher on the closed source software and lower on the open source software. I'm not sure. So I'm not sure whether liability should be totally gone with open source software, because I think that even with open source software you may have some responsibility. But I do think, because it's open source, it's of course it's different. Sure.
Any other questions from the room? Don't be shy. And if not, let's give a warm round of applause.
Yeah,
and
just wanted to add. So if people are shy, we'll be talking on a much smaller scale in the tent next to this one.
Yeah, it's called the Explodey Teepee, and it's just right next door. So please be welcome to join Rejo there. And let's give him a warm hand for his talk.
Thank you.